How do you conceptualize democracy? Republicanism.
Well, I think there's some different layers of republicanism. The most banal level, we've got the idea of non-hereditary rule, of public rule in some way, which has become synonymous with democracy in the 20th century. There's some other literature out there which I think you could ascribe to sort of a neo-Aristotelian sense of being part of a political community with some kind of civic life and active citizenship and so forth. And this being intrinsically valuable in some way. And this is probably best evident in Hannah Arendt's work. There's some communitarian thought that sometimes gets described and hooked into that. But there's a more recent sort of thread of literature that comes out of the kind of neo-Roman account of republicanism, which has been championed by people like Quentin Skinner and Philip Pettit and Rizzio Veroli, Richard Bellamy, scholars like that. And that takes the view that there is an account of civic life and of active citizenship in the state, but rather than being intrinsically valuable, it's instrumentally valuable in the sense that it's actually the pursuit of some sense of common or public liberty. And I got to say, in my own reading of the literature, that's become the dominant strand and dominant way the term republicanism has been used. So I think, not to silence other forms of republicanism, but I think that's become the dominant sort of feel of the republicanism. The word republicanism, anyway, is getting used in the democratic theory literature.
Right. So, just for our, or at least for myself, could you contrast in a sentence or two the exact difference between classic republicanism and neo-Roman republicanism?
That's a very, very difficult question. I'm a bit of a skeptic of the neo-Roman account can be considered a natural extension of these writers, of the writers, particularly going back as far as Greece. There is a sense of which myself and definitely Philip Pettit and Quentin Skinner rely back and use the words of people like Machiavelli or other scholars of that time to sort of talk about contemporary problems. But I think the writings of Philip Pettit anyway become very important around the notion of non-domination as being the conception of liberty that they pursue. And I think that I take the view that I try to use the neo-Roman account of republicanism as a kind of its own sort of bedrock for the arguments that I make. Sure, sometimes I go back and look at Rousseau and look at Machiavelli, and sometimes use their words as kind of inspiration for what I'm doing. But to claim that this neo-Roman republicanism is completely consistent with previous forms of thinking, let alone going back to the Greeks, I think that's probably an unsustainable argument.
Okay.
I'm interested in the future of Republican ideas rather than sort of the past in some respects. I'm interested in as a public philosophy in many ways.
Very interesting. And how do you conceptualize democracy?
Well, democracy is, I guess, again, there's different layers to this. I mean, at the most surface level, it's a formal system for developing and enabling public rule, selecting representatives, managing the affairs of state through democratic processes, and there's a variety of different systems and models for that. I think also you have to, in democratic theory, think about not just the democratic bones of political life, but also think about the muscles that make those bones sort of work. To use a physiological metaphor, and that is a kind of the civic culture, civil society, the role of non-governmental organisations and social movements, accounts of citizenship, and the actual deliberation that makes democracy work is also being really, really important. And that's why I think in democratic theory, there's so many different accounts out there that are about representative democracy, how we actually make representative democracy work, and the liberal democratic model. But I also really think there's a lot of value in looking at the deliberative approaches to democracy, which I think relate and connect in some ways with republican conceptions of democracy, but also the kind of deliberative accounts of that have this emphasised the nature of the discussions rather than the nature of institutions. The idea of having inclusive, the normative desirability of having inclusive discussions that where the agents are reflective about their political life and are willing to change their views in relation to discourse to make democratic decisions. And to go one step further, to look at the work of somebody like John Dryzek with his account of discursive democracy, where the idea is that you represent not just people, but you also represent discourses. So in the most kind of, I think, creative and quite interesting sense, you could have a chamber of discourses attached to a parliamentary system where you have a political space where instead of representing people, you represent different discourses, like you'd represent the interests of green, the environmentalism, animal rights, human rights,
mm-hmm.
neo-liberalism, other kinds of discourses. For me, that deeper sense of looking at democracy rather than just looking at the electoral systems, I should say, is actually what I find really interesting. That talks about civil society and those mm-hmm. other aspects as being really important to democracy, both within the state, but also the possibility of there being democracy beyond the state.
And so neo-republicanism, would that fall under the umbrella of democratic theory, or would that be something that's running parallel to it?
Yeah, I think the neo-Roman account is an account of political theory in its broader sense, because it's arguing for a particular political conception of non-domination, and then talking about the various institutions and policies we can enact to make that condition of non-domination possible in our context. But also I think the neo-Roman account is a normative account of democracy. It's an argument of how democracy should look like. I think there are, I have to say, I'm sure there's liberal Democrats out there who don't see a connection between republicanism and deliberative democracy, but I find it very hard to conceive of an account of republican governance that doesn't have strong commitment to deliberation. I think it's a crucial element. And I think there is some very important connections between that. And Philip Pettit, I think, has in recent work has sort of drawn those sort of connections a little bit. And one of his accounts is of an idea of contestatory democracy, the idea that us as citizens have both the power of being authors, we choose the representatives who write down laws and create laws, but we also have power of being editors as well. We can edit that law through referenda and other forms of involvement in political life in order to make those rules and laws promote some conception of the public good. And I think that process of being editors requires some conception of deliberation.
Mm-hmm.
Some idea of sitting down talking about things and being willing to change our opinions. I don't know if republicanism is as free form as some accounts of deliberative democracy, but I definitely see them as being connected in some way.
So there is this insistence almost in this neo-Roman model of the active citizen.
Yeah, this is a really, I guess, big issue for Republicans. I still think about this on a fairly regular basis, is this idea of an active conception of citizenship, the idea of having been politically engaged in political life, is something that contrasts with citizenship that we have now, where citizenship is seen in fairly minimalistic terms. Where we, within 3 or 4 years, we rock up to the booth, cast our vote, and then we're gone. And I've got to say, I sometimes think about the account of an active citizenship as being slightly unrealistic. And I think that's a real challenge for Republicans to actually argue, to talk about how we can make citizenship more active without it being burdensome, where it's... And I don't think that's how neo-Romans see active citizenship. I think active citizenship is not necessarily every day getting involved in political life. It's a willingness to get involved in political life. If a situation where there's a situation of some form of domination going on, And that to flip it, just to contrast again with liberalism, and going a bit further on this idea of active citizenship, another important component of republicanism, which is also, I think, a bit controversial, contrast with contemporary forms of political identity, is that they actually use the word patriotism in a deeper sense of a willingness, a love of country, a love of your country's liberty. And that contrasts with particularly liberal accounts of nationalism, where nationalism is a common way of life, common lived practices. And invoking the language of patriotism has always got well-known dangers. And I'm definitely very conscious of pushing patriotism too much. But I think there is a count of... Within republicanism, there is a balanced account of how patriotism can be fostered and developed. It is a love of liberty, and a love of a particular country, but doesn't fall down the path of chauvinism and xenophobia and things like that. And there's a book by Rizzio Varoli. His work on patriotism, I think, is the gold standard of talking about republican accounts of patriotism.
Interesting. One question that I'd really like to address. So we see that there has been a lot of, I would say, similar themes between our discussions on republicanism and democracy. I'm rather concerned that we, in a discursive manner, will be muddling these terms. So if I recall correctly, and please forgive me if I don't, there is the statement, republicanism is a normative conception of democracy. So taking that line, what exactly are we doing there?
Well, I think there are obvious to there's definitely a crossover between two ways of looking at democracy, but one is an analytical one where you try to describe democracy and to understand how power works, how power is constrained in it, how representatives are chosen, what sort of historical dynamics shape democracy. And then there's a normative question of what democracy should look like, what sort of goals should democracy perform, how should democracy be constrained, or how should it be... have the rules been set. And I think ultimately democracy boils down to questions of representation. How do we choose representatives? The questions of the more deliberative side of things, of how do we enable discussion? How do we enable political culture to support democracy? And this isn't just a academic problem. This is a policy-making problem for states that are involved in peace-building and state-building missions around the world, in East Timor or Kosovo. How do we enable civic culture to enable democracy to work? And also there's the well-trodden issues of constitutionalism, that democracy requires there to be meta-rules of how power is constrained and shaped. And how do we change the rules? How do we change the constitution itself?
That's right, who defines the constitution?
Yeah. So, I mean, this is a question where... Republican scholars have things to say, but that's not the only normative account. We've got accounts of liberal accounts of democracy, deliberative accounts, particularly of the more critical kind. We've got environmental accounts of democracy, including arguments that come from people like Robin Eckersley around the Green State, the idea of having a state that... engages in environmental discourse in a far more significant way than the liberal democratic state. And also, of course, we have cosmopolitan conceptions of democracy that want to unpack democracy from the nation state and do enact forms of global or transnational democracy. So there's no one normative account of what democracy should look like.
That's right.
But I don't want to for a second suggest that normative account of looking at democracy is the only way of looking at democracy.
No, not at all.
Analytical accounts are still crucially important.
Of course. Yeah. No, my intention is simply just to explore that axis.
Yeah.
So I beg your forgiveness of have this incorrectly understood, but what I understand is republicanism being, this neo-Roman conception of it as being a tool that we can use to achieve whichever analytic conceptions of democracy may be present in a given society.
Yeah, look, I think the best way we'd look at it is the neo-Roman account is one way. I do think that the neo-Roman account does have a conceptual strong focus on the state, so state-level democracy. I think that the neo-Roman account does, and I've tried to touch on this with my writing, have an account of that relates to international politics. That's not just about democracy in one place. I think republicanism's always had that, looking at the context that states, democratic republican states, could exist within.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of the day, it's just one account. It's one particular conception that requires active citizenship, you know, a public culture, a culture of public participation and oversight of government, which is a little bit different than liberalism. There's definitely some... I often think of republicanism being... having some overlaps with liberal accounts and also overlapping with some deliberative democracy accounts. But there is a... I would not for a moment want to suggest that republicanism should be taken off the shelf, pull off your Quentin Skinner or your Philip Pettit and just run with those alone. I think that there is some... Yeah, one of my things I believe quite strongly is that, you know, for the kind of challenges that that we're going to face as democratic theorists and also as citizens, we're going to require more than one theory. And I think that, you know, I'd be looking at some of the accounts of deliberative democracy, I'd be looking at accounts of republicanism. I'd also be looking at some accounts of some cosmopolitan scholarship. I don't think that one account, one normative account of what democracy should look like can be uncritically enacted. I think that's going to require a series of different theories to... normative theories to bring to table to address, you know, democracy in an increasingly globalizing age.
That's very... I agree with that. Also on the analytic side, we see these new, I'd call them, methodologies. So we've got Ulrich Beck and Edgar Grandes Call, who is in the introduction to their special issue, The Varieties of Second Modernity.
Yeah.
Therein, they made the call for this, it's a cosmopolitan turn in social sciences. So adopting methodologies that would somehow marry with the realities of second modernity.
Yeah.
We also see Jack Goody, I think midway between pages 150 and 170 of The Theft of History, his monograph a few years ago, he proposed a cross-cultural analytic methodology. And I think this ties in very well to a line I first heard from David Held, that, you know, we are now in an age of uncertainty, right? Everything's up in the air. And so we've got all these conceptions, normative, analytical, of democracy. And I would say also of republicanism, because that's quite varied on that end of the spectrum. And I suppose to me, we're still struggling to figure out, you know, what... any kind of post-universalistic commonalities you'd have between everything. It is some kind of string theory.
I'm not familiar with all the details of those scholars you mentioned, but I think there's a lot of very important insights there. From the point of view that the age of uncertainty, I always think about this when I discuss... political life with people who are not trained in international relations or political theory. If you think we're uncertain about political life as scholars and we study it, imagine if you're a concerned citizen, how you look at the world, you look at WTO rulings, you look at climate change, you look at the nations of the UN, the role the United Nations plays. It's doubly uncertain for people who look at political life with an interest. So I think the age of uncertainty and the age of politics of complexity, I think, are very very important ways of looking at it.
Brilliant. And I'd like to just step back a little bit to our previous question. And there was mention that this work on neo-Roman republicanism, that normative conception of democracy, is more fitting for the state and international levels. Does that exclude your work from local governance?
No, look, I mean, I, I think if you look at the work of neo-Roman scholars, and there's a lot of different positions out there, I think most of the work actually is focused on the state. I think if we were to criticise Philip Pettit's book Republicanism, which was published a little over 10 years ago, you could almost be overly critical and say that it was, you know, there wasn't enough written about the global international dimensions of the Republican state would need to be enmeshed within. I mean, there is a sense that Republican thinking is still in early stages of thinking about how to exist in this age of uncertainty that you were talking about before. I think I wrote a book in 2005 called Liberty Beyond Neoliberalism, which tried to sort of use republicanism as a foil, as a counter-argument to what I see as the fairly entrenched politics of neoliberalism that we can see around us. And I think the contrast would not be a bit simplistic, but the idea of a state and a society focused on economic outcomes, individual outcomes, I think contrasts with republicanism, which is more concerned with a public conception of liberty and a concern not just of individuals but of societies. And I thought it was interesting sort of contrast, but I still think that there are other scholars who are working within Republican lines that are grappling with questions about domination in a globalising context, and grappling with questions of security in a globalising international context. But I think it's definitely the case that Republican scholarship has actually historically been focused quite strongly on the state. And extending that view into international and global politics is still in early stages, despite the fact that I've written on it and other people have as well. So there's still a lot of questions to be tackled.
Indeed, isn't there? Yeah. There always are.
Yes.
How, in your opinion, does globalization affect? So let's look at the adverse perspective, so not republicanism affecting, but how does this phenomenon of globalization affect republicanism and democracy, that complex matrix?
Well, there's a lot of issues here. I mean, I think at one level, globalization dramatically undermines the kind of liberal democratic state, and this argument, I think, has been best stated by David Held, with his focus on disjunctures between decision makers and decision takers, basically, mm-hmm. between leaders and of a democratic state and its population. And we can think of numerous issues where decisions made elsewhere are having dramatic impacts upon people's life that are breaking that notion that you can have some control over your political destiny. There's also increasing questions about where should the borders of the demos lie.
That's right.
You can see this question being asked most pressing, I guess, in Europe, but across the world. It's you can have a notion of a democratic state being determined by the boundaries of a certain political culture, normally around nationalistic lines, or a boundary of effect, who you affect through your own actions. So the questions of where the boundaries of the democratic state are, I think, are increasingly pressing problem. It's also the fact that globalisation is producing new political spaces for meaningful political activity. And you can think about the roles that non-governmental organisations and social movements play in as transnational actors. I think it's very the more recent work by people like Robert Gooden and John Dreiser, you see this argument that these forms of transnational forms of activism and attempted forms of trying to hold power to account are a kind of an incipient form of democratisation, where living in various forms of NGOs aren't just instrumental actors trying to get A to live up to their promises, but the deeper question of they're actually creating rules and principles that undermine the first attempts we have of trying to sort of limit power at a global stage. And I think you can argue that is... Now, while it's not clearly a developed global franchise of people as citizens, you can start to see some forms of accountability and moral and deliberative pressure that is moving away from international politics being a strategic realm of states pushing each other around.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's why it's such an interesting thing to study, interesting thing to teach, and also quite overwhelming, I think, for sometimes when you look at what's going on in international politics. All these actors are out there creating rules and creating principles and contesting power. So they're the dimensions of globalisation, democracy. I also think, just to come back to neoliberalism for a moment, I mean, I think the rise of neoliberalism has meant not only is there a shift of political life from local politics to the impact of global politics, but there's also been a shift from the state to markets. And I think there's a lot of political discussions now around the benefits and the costs of global capitalism, particularly after the global financial crisis. Although obviously in the 90s there were a lot of protests against global capitalism which were politically interesting. But the question is, do we try to regulate global capitalism, or do we just hang on for dear life? And I think that's an interesting question as well for our generation. I think some people are getting fatigued by holding on to this form of global capitalism. Some other people are willing to see where we're going to go.
Indeed. Well, I think there's a couple of things there. One, I think our discussion relates quite strongly to John Keane's recent work on monetary democracy.
Yeah.
That fits in very well. Another thing with this mention you had of the global capital markets, to me it falls into this concept that I created, I suppose. I'm not too certain. I label it now competitive law, but it was born as competitive public policy and public administration as a means of bypassing this regulate-deregulate debate, this private-slash-public debate. We might call it a third way.
Yeah.
It was really just the argument that we shouldn't even be considering something as a deregulation. We should only be considering it as a situation of requiring re-regulation.
Mm. Yeah.
Because if we're not casting that light of public scrutiny on an activity, then how are we to know which wolves are at bay?
Look, I think this idea you mentioned, and also John Keane's notion of monetary democracy, both point to this question that I think is really important to contemporary global governance. That's the question of accountability. We've got these institutions out there with enormous power. We sometimes use the term, the democratic deficit, to talk about the gap we have between these groups making decisions and our capacity to influence them. But I think all these ideas really point to this idea that we're part of the activism we see around non-governmental organisations, and also some forms of parliamentary oversight and committees, are an attempt to try to hold private bodies and also some international and public bodies to some sort of routinised forms of public accountability. And I think when we start to look at private market actors, it becomes incredibly hard, because incredibly complicated, because we need to have more or less a very significant critical mass of states or powerful actors willing to actually go down this path. All you need is a few states to say, look, we're not going to hold we're not going to hold capitalism to account. We're going to accept the costs and benefits of global capitalism to undermine any form of agreement. So that's the dilemma we face. If we want accountability to exist, it's got to be, particularly of private market actors, has to be a wide-ranging, quite deep consensus of where we want to go, and that's definitely doesn't exist at the moment. Mm-hmm. Even with some very significant financial crises in the recent years, and also ongoing now.
That's true. I wonder what you would think of this idea of an endemic lack of long-term goals. Mm-hmm. And how does that fit with neo-republicanism?
Yeah, look, this is an issue. I think the question of leadership is reappearing quite strongly in political theory literature, in a normative account of what leaders should do, what roles they should have. We're thinking most notably climate change here.
Mm-hmm.
How does political leaders like Obama, who might have 4 or 8 years, is that enough time to build up a consensus to sort of address these longer term issues? Ultimately, I don't know how to answer this question. I think it's a really crucial question, because leadership, particularly long-term leadership, is something that is definitely in a deficit at the moment. I think one of the issues I always think about when it comes to leadership is the reaction that George W. Bush had to the 9/11 attacks, where it was kind of like a very kind of immediate, we're going to treat this as a case of war, which was understandable in some dynamics, and I think people in America particularly would understand that as a very natural response, but I didn't see much evidence of long-term how we're going to sort of win the peace type of thing. Mm-hmm. And I always contrast that with Roosevelt in World War II, where soon after Pearl Harbor happened, Roosevelt was thinking, what's the long-term strategy here? How are we going to win the peace, to use his language? And I think that contrast is, I don't know whether political leaders 50, 60, 70 years ago had more time to think about the long-term picture than politicians today, where it's all about short-term polls and winning the next election. Maybe the whole world political leadership has become overloaded in some ways. I always love the metaphor that gets used around the US president, that the US president's always sort of drinking from a fire hose in terms of information coming at him is so intense that his capacity to digest it in some meaningful ways is pretty limited. But I don't think that republicanism or any other theory has quite grappled with this question of information overload and the question of that you're posing. I think it is a question all theories have to ask.
Oh, very fascinating. I think that's an excellent segue to our final question. In a general sense, what implications does neo-republicanism have for contemporary politics, especially when we look at public policy and administration?
Yeah. Oh, that's an interesting question. I mean, I wrote the book that I wrote in 2005, Liberty Beyond Neoliberalism, was at first blush, it was a kind of an argument for reinvigorating the state, which is an argument that isn't made a lot at the moment in political theory. I mean, in some ways, political theory has gone from, particularly in relation to democracy, has gone in 20 years from a complete focus on the state to an almost complete focus on global forms of governance and transnational democracy and so forth. And my argument is always that, sure, these things are happening. I'm not a denier of globalization at all. I think these transnational things are very important to understanding contemporary political life. But the state's still really important in all this. One of the authors I really like on looking at globalization, people like Manuel Castells in Saskia Sassen, who have been talking about globalization as being this transnational social phenomenon that actually exists within states in many ways. States are the ones who've enabled globalization to exist by giving rights to capital and, in some cases, people, to enable them to move around and to do sort of have the speed and mobility that we've now become largely accustomed to. So I think that my argument that the state matters doesn't mean that that these transnational dynamics don't matter. The reason why I think republicanism's got some interesting things to say about political life comes down to that I think republicanism is concerned with neoliberalism and the kind of private emphasis on private rights and private property type of arguments, and the privileging transnational capitalist kind of processes. That I think Republicans are worried about the impacts of inequality and some forms of suppressions of individual liberty that come out of this globalised context, particularly through insecurity, economic insecurity. I'm always that Rousseau quote of, I can't remember the exact wording of it, but the idea that people shouldn't be able to buy another or be forced to sell themselves type of thing is a very important kind of dynamic that's that demonstrates, I think, the kind of some of the equality, some of the importance of equality in Republican thinking that's, and substantive equality that's important in Republican thinking. And the idea that not having a state that's shaped predominantly by private interest, that actually serves public goals, and I think this is a kind of discourse that's interesting and relevant to talking about public problems. I think there's a lot of Republicans are focusing on on particular public issues. I've done a little bit of writing on some environmental issues from a Republican perspective, which always sounds very strange because Republicanism does, again, is a statist, underpinned is a status kind of account of political life. It's very humanist. The Republicans talking about the rights of animals is pretty, or rights of the environment more generally is pretty, pretty few and far between. But I just basically come back to this issue that the state matters. That if you can have a Republican account of the state that's involved in concerning about the notion of liberty being not just an individual trait that you possess, but actual context of where power is moderated, this starts to open the door to being concerned about things like environmental issues. Because the decisions that we're making at the moment in relation to how we use natural resources and how we produce CO2 in the ways that we are and lead to climate change is probably going to severely condition the liberty of people in the future. And that's something that we, I think, have to start thinking about. Thinking about domination and the use of transnational power, not just across decisions made in one country can affect other countries, but also the fact that decisions made now can affect future generations. So the transnational and transgenerational sides of domination mean that we have to think about public policy in quite interesting ways. And I think that that's one account, one reason why Republican, the neo-Roman account of Republicanism anyway, has got some things to say. The other thing about it is I think that the neo-Roman account, though it's focused on the state and having this kind of democratic state, requires forms of collaboration between states, quite intense forms of Republican global governance, that these states and citizens within them just can't be just look at my own interests and forget everybody else, promote my own liberty at the cost of other people. There needs to be some degree of reciprocity between Republican states that, hey, look, I want to promote liberty here, we've got to be it's going to be consistent with your liberty over there. And that means, and Philip Pettit's work on republicanism illustrates this idea of international cooperation and global governance is required between states, and that citizens may have to have some kind of connection to the global governance bodies that exist above states. His account of contestatory democracy enables there to be that form of contestation beyond the state. So there's some space that republicanism not only identifies domination, particularly as it exists in transnational ways, but also talks about some of the means by which we can achieve them. But that's not to say, again, just to return to something we've already mentioned, that I don't think republicanism can have all the answers. I still think that the kind of traditional republican virtues of the citizen being politically engaged and being willing to be to engage and talk about political life is going to have to start to be developed in transnational ways. And that's going to mean some engagement with a kind of a cosmopolitan kind of virtue. It's a kind of concern for other people in other parts of the world. Some willingness to change your opinion, to be reflexive about things. I think these are virtues that are going to be important to future Republican citizens just as much as the kind of the old-fashioned notions of courage and temperance, all those kind of things that are important to sort of Republican accounts of virtue. I think that Republicanism, of moderating, of having the state under some sort of degree of more public concern and control, being concerned about domination and the liberty of your country people, but also people in other parts of the world, and thinking about what sort of global governance arrangements are required are all things that that Republicanism is working on. And I think they're going to continue to be important issues for the foreseeable future. Keeping us all busy writing chapters and books.
Good. There'll never be a shortage. I wonder what Machiavelli would say about this cosmopolitan virtue.
Yes, well, that's right. I mean, it depends which book, which of his works you're thinking about. I think there's interesting thing about Republicans is this notion of that their concern for a political community is instrumental. It's a political community to serve particular ends. And obviously in the discourses, Machiavelli points to this, some of Montesquieu's work points to this as well. the important thing is that institutions that are appropriate to promoting liberty have to change. At one level, I don't think Machiavelli would be all surprised by the fact that we have to change our institutions, including our notions of political community, to think about them in new ways in order to have the power needed to address these problems. Because I think the biggest contrast between Republican accounts and other accounts is Republicans are very clear-minded about the fact that if you want to produce liberty, if you want to produce good public outcomes, you've got to marshal power to do it. You just don't, you know, don't do it by suppressing power or ignoring power or wishing it away. You need power to achieve public things, and that's got to be publicly controlled. And that's the Republican argument. In our age, the state still matters, so we've got to control that state and use that state to produce kind of Republican outcomes. So I think, you know, Machiavelli and other scholars in the long lineage of republicanism would, if they understood the political contours of our time, would expect those institutions and public sentiments to adapt to that kind of context, political context.
Brilliant. Well, Dr. Steven Slaughter, thank you so very much for honouring us with your time.
Thank you for talking with me.